नमस्ते लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, एस्पायरिंग डांसर्स, म्यूजिशियंस, म्यूजिकोलॉजिस्ट्स, स्कॉलर्स, मेडिकल प्रैक्टिशनर्स, साइंटिस्ट्स इन वेरियस डोमेन्स। नाउ लेट्स ट्राई अंडरस्टैंडिंग फ्रॉम द जीव सृष्टि पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू योगा। As I was speaking in my previous video about the Ishvara Srishti, I was speaking about the Trilokya aspect, that is Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwara Tattva. Brahma created universe, Vishnu created the ambience, and Shiva is the sole cause for Srishti, Laya and Jati, Gati, creating that kind of set of rules or whatever, 36 tattvas. Now, why is the necessity for Ishvara Srishti to have 36 tattvas? This is where the Jiva Srishti's role comes into picture, which is directly related to Akara and Nirakara Swarupa, wherein the practical importance of Virata Purusha comes into picture. At the same time, Purusha is the soul aspect for the cosmic being. Understand that it has a deeper and depth aspect to this, and this is where the classical dance and classical music's practical importance or practical understanding comes into picture. If one understands this subject to the core, that's when the practical understanding of Vedas and Upanishads happen. And on the other hand, Purusha is the essence of intelligence or the intellect. Purusha here means Ishvara. Ishvara or Shiva or Shakta. Now, why is it related to intelligence or intellect? One needs to have the understanding, because the 36 tattvas which are there, they are the standard procedures, they are the systematic approach, and that's the schematic way to understand the human existence as a whole. The point is, today we are tending to forget about those 36 tattvas, as a result of which whole of the destruction is happening of the human mankind, and everyone are turning to ashes. If we see Rati and Kamadeva's skit or the Kamadeva's role, when Indra sent Kamadeva for disturbing Shiva from the meditation, deeper meditation, wherein Kamadeva uses 5 arrows related to lust and other things. That's a different aspect. I will let you know. That's a different story, and they have created that story. Now, when Kamadeva uses the 5th arrow, that's when Shiva gets consciousness, and he understands that Kamadeva is the reason for this. So he turns Kamadeva to ashes. Now, these 5 arrows, which Kamadeva was having, one needs to understand from the spiritual aspect as well as philosophical aspect also. Let's not try to understand that subject from that point of view only. This is where the Jiva Srishti's Bija or the Jiva Srishti's seed comes into picture. Of course, Indra had to wake Lord Shiva from the deep sleep because there was something happening and Shiva's help was needed. If Shiva was sleeping, Shiva was doing meditation into deep meditation, he would not come out. He knew that. That is the story. Let's take this subject from a different aspect, wherein we need to understand the philosophy or the spiritual aspect of this turning into ashes. One needs to understand we have panchendriyas. We need to understand panchendriyas from a very point of human nature or the human psyche. Once the human psyche or the human psychology or the psychometry gets overboard, that's when the imbalance of the thoughts or imbalance of the nature starts happening. This is very important aspect. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. I am not denying Rati and Kamadeva's aspect is related to lust. But let's not stipulate the subject to lust itself, lust or the attraction. Let's try getting into the deeper and depth aspect of this. Understand this. Our human here, Purusha, that is a reason why he says Purusha is the essence of intelligence and intellectual mind, and it symbolizes Ishvara Srishti and Ishvara as a whole. And this is where Swarupa comes into picture. Akara Swarupa and Nirakara Swarupa. When I say Akara Swarupa is again, it has its own limits. When you start taking Akara Swarupa to its core and start playing with it, again, destruction happens there. One needs to understand, you cannot take Akara as and when you want to take, or you cannot take Akara Swarupa at its will. Try not to play with it. Try to think about Akara, but in a legitimate way, with limitations. Once you understand this Akara Swarupa or the Akara Rupa, you create that image and start understanding the five arrows of Kamadeva from the philosophy and spiritual front. Believe me, life will be very easier. You will not find any atrocities, or you will not find any kind of destruction of this sort, whatever that we are seeing today. Today we have taken things as granted, and we have played with it for no reason. Unfortunately, to an extent, this universe can take. We need to understand Akara Sarupa or Akara Rupa. And then, once that is done, that's when the unification of the Prakriti and Purusha happens. And then the balancing act starts happening. In the universe, once this unreal and real aspect happens, we have many planets. We have many things in the universe, in the gigantic universe. They start acting balanced. However, this is what is called Maya. One should understand this. Am I trying to understand this? Ladies and gentlemen, please do understand the five senses that we have, or the five senses, eyes, lips, breasts, ears, and the pineal gland or whatever it is. All of these form very important aspect. The pineal gland or the Mooladhara or the vaginal gland, vaginal part in the female, and pineal gland in the male form a key part. If you are not trying to understand these five senses, or if you are not trying to limit yourself in understanding, you are trying to exploit that energy that happens in Mooladhara. It gives negative energies. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. Today atrocities, or today if we are tending to see gang rapes or whatever it is, we are not trying to limit ourselves. We are just trying to exploit all these five senses, and we are not trying to create that balance of act. These five senses that we have as a whole, and this in return, with this nature, however, karma plays a key role, individual goes off. But this is indirectly creating that destruction in the society as well as the universe, creating those negative vibrations. And this is where the practical importance of Upanishads and Vedas happen. If one thinks Rati and Kamadeva's role was simply to wake up, Ishvara from the meditation. No, it's not that. It has a wider meaning in that. It is not only from the lust point of view. Let's not take the subject from the lust point of view. Let's try understanding the subject from the Akara Swarupa and Nirakara Swarupa. Try to take the Akara Rupa from a different angle. Understand, take it from the positive sense. Try not to exploit it. Enjoy it. Definitely, yes, you can enjoy. But not at the cost of others. Not at the cost of nature. And this is what has happened with the nature. nature could be human being, non-living being, or anything. But try to enjoy it. Enjoy it to what extent you need to. But let it not be exploited. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. There is a wider meaning and there is a wider perspective. And this is an open-ended question, or this is an open-ended debate for the scholars in fine arts and culture, specifically the classical dance form. If scholars are telling Rati and Kamadeva's enactment is relating to only lust, I say Rati and Kamadeva's enactment is relating to the human consciousness and human beings' well-being, the sound vibrations, or the alphabet's vibrations, whatever that we spell, whatever that we pronounce. Do not act. This I have been hearing from many of the scholars and dancers, and there has been quite a few arguments. There have been, in fact, though vibrations and frequencies with certain amount of magnitude do happen in the human being, because that's one medium which translates and acts as a modulator and demodulator. However, the sound of one vibration is intermediary between the pure consciousness and the physical objects. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. The sound of one vibration. Sound of one vibration is the intermediary between pure consciousness. As I always keep on telling, one needs to have the pure and parity of consciousness, which is what is developed in the fine arts and culture, specifically when it comes to classical dance and music. Because classical dance, be it any form, all the 8 forms, the lyrics which are pronounced by Natvanar or the singer or the individual creates those vibrations in the air which touches the human body and creates those ripples within our body. That's where it starts. Then it goes to the consciousness level. Then it goes to the subconscious level. Then it goes to the superconscious level. Then it goes to the pure consciousness level. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. This is the practical phenomena. This is the phenomena behind dance and music. And this is where the therapeutic part happens. And that is the reason why today most of the doctors, most of the practitioners, neuropsychiatric practitioners, neuropsychologists have started experimenting on this. The Vedic rhythms, the Vedic rhymes, the Vedas and Upanishads, specifically Rudram, Namakam and Chamakam, which has those variations, those patterns, the sound patterns which happen. It's like pronunciation and enunciation of the words creates those positive vibrations. This is the practical significance. At the same time, when we talk about physical objects are like you interpret within yourself. You create those. You tend to create those within yourself in a way like project yourself, and then as a result of it, the output that comes out. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. This is the practical significance, and this is the proper scheme, or this is the proper structure, and this is the way things happen. And that is a reason why today classical dance or the classical music is considered or is being experimented as a part of therapy. There is always this relationship of pure consciousness and the physical objects. When we talk about physical objects, that doesn't mean chairs or whatever it is that you see physically. It is how you are creating or interpreting in your subconscious mind. This is what is the beauty of classical dance and classical music. Situation is today, most of the classical dancers or classical musicologists or musicians are not getting to understand this intricate and intriguing aspect of the subject, which is easy, which can be understood, but hard to be explained. It can be understood by one who is seeking towards it, one who is trying to understand it. These clubbed with Angaharas and Upangaharas, Karanas, 108 Karanas, where you tend to put mudras, creates those positive energy. That positive energy generates that energy. That is what is called Shakti. Shakta is nothing but, here is the physical object. Ishvara Srishtis. This is the beauty. Understand it, ladies and gentlemen. That is the reason why one needs to understand Ishvara Tattva from the 36 Tattvas point of view. And this is what was the Bharata's aim to create. At the same time, he has emphasized on entertainment aspect also, nevertheless. But moral of the story, bottom line of all of this exercise is reaching to that self-conscious level or self-realization level. He just wanted every individual to understand the relationship or reference, cross-reference of pure consciousness and the physical objects, leading to real and unreal aspects, nitya and anitya, illusion and delusion. And this is where the delusion of thoughts get filtered, and the illusion also gets filtered, and that's when the attachment and detachment comes into picture. This attachment, in the sense, whatever performance that he or she does is at a subliminal level of pure consciousness in the physical objects, for some time you get engrossed. Everyone gets engrossed in that. For some time, which will take to the level where he or she can concentrate, that concentration level to the highest point is what happens, leading to understanding of illusion. Hey man, this is illusion. Let's not get delusioned with this aspect. Let's try understanding this. This is real, this is unreal. And that's when he or she gets to that pure realization level. And this is the practical importance of the vibrational forces or the frequency levels. Though it is an open challenge for the medical practitioners or the scientists or the scholars or the renowned personalities in the field of fine arts and music, if they come up with a question, whatever that you are telling argument, we do not support. If they are telling, fine, let them come on. I have the answers for it. There are certain things which can be seen, which cannot be unseen. It has to be felt. Not everything can be felt. And this is what is yoga. This is what is the different. This is where the space and time aspect comes into picture. Ladies and gentlemen, talk the subject from the viewpoint of four epithets. Epithets, respectively. So far I was talking about the conscious, subconscious, and I was talking about the pure reference of pure consciousness and the physical object of the yoga therapy from a viewpoint of classical dance and classical music. Let's try understanding the subject from the viewpoint of four epithets, which are restlessness, other is turbulence, and powerful and obstinate. These are the few epithets or the like few traits of the normal human being which come by default right from the day he or she comes down to earth and starts his or her journey from the infancy level. Now, why these four traits come in by is the question. Though one may say that these are developed off late, but to be imprecise, these four qualities, that is restlessness, turbulence, powerful and obstinacy, attitude starts developing from the day one. A young infant has that obstinacy. He or she is very powerful with his or her thoughts. And the kind of turbulence that he or she will have, specifically at the infancy stage between 0 and 5th year, is at a higher level, because they don't know anything. The only thing that they know is they want it. That's it. They want whatever they want. If they are hungry, they need that milk to be breastfed by the mother. Like that of a cow, like that of a calf hitting the cow's udder for milk and sucking that milk. like that infant has that attitude, because he doesn't know, only he or she doesn't know. The only thing that he or she knows is he is hungry, that's it. And the only source for that is mother's two breasts, from which milk comes, and his hunger gets satisfied. And in fact, that is what is called obstinacy. If a child does not get milk, or if a child does not get is not being fed when he or she is hungry, see his actions, his or her actions. His or her actions will be like turbulent. They roll on the floor, they cry loudly, they stay restless. They will throw whatever that they have. They will hit. They will do whatever they can. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. These traits come inborn. They come by default. For a kid. Though here a kid need not learn dance, or he or she need not learn the classical art form or music at all, because they don't have that capacity to understand. The maturity level starts at second year, or for a girl child, it starts around first year. For a boy, it starts around second or third year. He or she starts understanding things. I need not be restless for this. Mother will give. Then he starts understanding. Because during infancy, what happens is the only thing that they see is the mother's help. They will be in mother's lap or someone's lap, and mostly mother's lap, because mother gives milk. Milk is the only source food for them. They don't eat any liquid food, any solid food as such. Solid food cannot get digested. The only source that they will have is that liquid kind of thing, either juice or whatever it is. So this kind of restlessness attitude and the kind of turbulence, powerful obstinacy starts developing after fifth year. The moment he or she starts dancing, learns dance, it is the responsibility, and it is the prime importance for a teacher or guru to teach what is restlessness meaning, what is turbulence meaning, what is powerful meaning, what is obstinacy meaning, from the viewpoint of philosophy and spiritual, in a very simple terms. Let's say restlessness. They need to teach the kid that he or she will be getting it. Don't worry. Mother is there. She will take care of you. It is like showing that consoling attitude, counseling attitude. This turbulence is what happens in everyone's. This cannot be taught for the infant kids, but it can be taught after 5th year or 6th year. But only thing one needs to do is explain him or her patiently, understand, make him or her understand that turbulence happens due to this. You need to go in a systematic way. Kids will hear. Kids will have that, you know, patience. But once he or she reaches 15 plus, turbulence goes to the peak. Turbulence needs to be nurtured at a very early age. This is a very important aspect. The turbulent nature has to be nurtured and structured in a very schematic way, especially for the kids. Once this kid understands that patience is a key for everything, this turbulence attitude will be wiped out and powerful. You have to teach the kid or the infant from first year or second year, because that's when he or she starts speaking. Tell him or her, you are powerful, your mind is powerful, you can do anything, but do it in a pure way, parity way. Explain him or her with the mythology stories, moral stories, whatnot. Try to explain him in a detailed way. Once he or she starts grabbing or understanding that subject at a first year or second year level, maybe he or she may hear or may not hear, but the moment you explain him or you tell him this story or that story, that will be stored in the infant's mind, in the subconscious mind, at some corner. What happens is, mother had told about this. He or she starts thinking, maybe at a later stage. So it's a prime responsibility of the parents. And when it comes to classical dance or classical music, art and culture, this has to be first given the proper definition and make every individual understand about what is restlessness, why restlessness comes into the mind. How do we control? What is it that a classical dance does? What is it that dance movement does that? Similar way, turbulence in the mind, how it can be controlled? What are the steps that you can take? Explanation part by the teacher or the guru has to be done. And how powerful you will be once you start practicing all of this in a systematic way and schematic way. And then obstinacy attitude. Obstinacy attitude has to be there when it comes to achieving of goals or aims. You have to be obstinate, but not for unreal things. That also has to be explained by teacher or a guru. Guru here means someone who is having the highest level of knowledge. Please, it's a note and disclaimer. All of us are not having that post or pre-qualification of calling as a guru, but we can call as a teachers. That's all, called as a teachers. Gurus have special qualities. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. So, talk the subject from the viewpoint of four epithets. Epithets, respectively. So far, I was talking about the conscious, subconscious, and I was talking about the pure reference of pure consciousness and the physical object of the yoga therapy from a viewpoint of classical dance and classical music. Let's try understanding the subject from the viewpoint of four epithets, which are restlessness, other is turbulence, and powerful and obstinate. These are the few epithets or the like few traits of the normal human being, which come by default right from the day he or she comes down to earth and starts his or her journey from the infancy level. Now, why these four traits come in by is the question. Though one may say that these are developed off late, but to be imprecise, these four qualities, that is restlessness, turbulence, powerful, and obstinacy, attitude starts developing from the day one. A young infant has that obstinacy. He or she is very powerful with his or her thoughts. And the kind of turbulence that he or she will have, specifically at the infancy stage between 0 and 5th year, is at a higher level, because they don't know anything. The only thing that they know is they want it. That's it. They want whatever they want. If they are hungry, they need that milk to be breastfed by the mother. Like that of a cow, like that of a calf hitting the cow's udder for milk and sucking that milk. Like that, infant has that attitude, because he doesn't know, only he or she doesn't know. The only thing that he or she knows is he is hungry, that's it. And the only source for that is mother's two breasts, from which milk comes, and his hunger gets satisfied. And in fact, that is what is called obstinacy. If a child does not get milk, or if a child does not get is not being fed when he or she is hungry, see his actions, his or her actions. His or her actions will be like turbulent. They roll on the floor. They cry loudly. They stay restless. They will throw whatever that they have. They will hit. They will do whatever they can. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. These traits come inborn. They come by default. For a kid, though here, a kid need not learn dance, or he or she need not learn the classical art form or music at all, because they don't have that capacity to understand. The maturity level starts at second year, or for a girl child, it starts around first year. For a boy, it starts around second or third year. He or she starts understanding things. I need not be restless for this. Mother will give. Then he starts understanding. Because during infancy, what happens is the only thing that they see is the mother's help. They will be in mother's lap or someone's lap, and mostly mother's lap, because mother gives milk. Milk is the only source food for them. They don't eat any liquid food, any solid food as such. Solid food cannot get digested. The only source that they will have is that liquid kind of thing, either juice or whatever. So this kind of restlessness attitude and the kind of turbulence, powerful obstinacy starts developing after fifth year. The moment he or she starts dancing, learns dance, it is the responsibility and it is the prime importance for a teacher or guru to teach what is restlessness meaning, what is turbulence meaning, what is powerful meaning, what is obstinacy meaning, from the viewpoint of philosophy and spiritual, in a very simple terms. Let's say restlessness. They need to teach the kid that he or she will be getting it. Don't worry. Mother is there. She will take care of you. It is like showing that consoling attitude, counseling attitude. This turbulence is what happens in everyone's. This cannot be taught for the infant kids, but it can be taught after fifth year or sixth year. But only thing one needs to do is explain him or her patiently, understand, make him or her understand that turbulence happens due to this. You need to go in a systematic way. Kids will hear. Kids will have that, you know, patience. But once he or she reaches 15 plus, turbulence goes to the peak. Turbulence needs to be nurtured at a very early age. This is a very important aspect. The turbulent nature has to be nurtured and structured in a very schematic way, especially for the kids. Once this kid understands that patience is a key for everything, this turbulence attitude will be wiped out and powerful. You have to teach the kid or the infant from first year or second year, because that's when he or she starts speaking. Tell him or her, you are powerful, your mind is powerful, you can do anything. but do it in a pure way, parity way. Explain him or her with the mythology stories, moral stories, whatnot. Try to explain him in a detailed way. Once he or she starts grabbing or understanding that subject at a first year or second year level, maybe he may hear, he or she may hear or may not hear, but the moment you explain him or you tell him this story or that story, that will be stored in the infant's mind, in the subconscious mind at some corner. What happens is, oh, mother had told about this. He or she starts thinking, maybe at a later stage. So it's a prime responsibility of the parents. And when it comes to classical dance or classical music, art and culture, this has to be first given the proper definition and make every individual understand about what is restlessness, why restlessness comes into the mind, how do we control, what is it that a classical dance does, what is it the dance movement does. That similar way, turbulence in the mind, how it can be controlled, what are the steps that you can take. Explanation part by the teacher or the guru has to be done, and how powerful you will be once you start practicing all of this in a systematic way and schematic way. And then obstinacy attitude. Obstinacy attitude has to be there when it comes to achieving of goals or aims. You have to be obstinate, but not for unreal things. That also has to be explained by teacher or a guru. Guru here means someone who is having the highest level of knowledge. Please, it's a note and disclaimer. All of us are not having that post or pre-qualification of calling as a guru, but we can call as a teachers. That's all, called as a teachers. Gurus have special qualities. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. So I conclude this video with a positive note and pointers for the individuals or the dancers. One needs to understand the four qualities or four epithets, which are restlessness of the mind or the monkey mind or the turbulence that happens due to the non-understanding of the real and unreal aspects, and the powerful attitude of the human consciousness or the human being as such, and the obstinate nature of the human being as an individual. Every classical dancer, every classical music or musicologist needs to understand this, because classical dance and classical music has the tenacity and power of taking control over this restlessness of mind or the monkey mind, and taking control over the turbulence of the thoughts or turbulence situations, gives that power within you, and it makes you more powerful in the sense, not showing the attitude that I am powerful, in a subtler way. Powerful here means you will be equipped and you will have that kind of knowledge
develop that kind of knowledge, you will be able to apply, you will be able to understand what is the true meaning of powerful over here. And the obstinacy nature also gets controlled. So far I was talking about restlessness, turbulence, powerful nature and obstinacy, the four traits of the human consciousness and sound and Purusha in cross-reference to the essence of intelligence or intellect. Let's try to understand furthermore the Samadhi state. Samadhi state is the state of the realization point beyond the realization point. So far, whatever that I was speaking is a realization point at a base level. At a highest level, the self-realization point is what is called Samadhi. This is what is called Samadhi state, where he or she comes to know what is real and what is unreal and stays attached as well as he stays attached. Yet again, he stays unattached with the worldly affairs. So there are two types of samadhis. One is samprajnata and asamprajnata. Now, this, when we talk about these two, before even talking about these two, there are two samadhis, vikalpa samadhi, nirvikalpa samadhi. Vikalpa samadhi is the base level samadhi where you understood whole of the gist of the universe with regards to real and unreal, nitya and anitya, and you are able to decide and act upon or take control over that restlessness, turbulence and powerful and obstinacy attitude. Nirvikalpa samadhi is the advanced stage where one is detached irrespective of whatever happens to him. He may have, he may not have. He may have money, he may not have money. He may not have anything, but still he stays controlled. This is what is called sthita prajnata. And this is what Sri Krishna talks about. However, when we talk about samprajnat, it is a supreme state level nevertheless, because the soul or the body or the mind has touched that supreme level and is able to recognize what is real and unreal. And he is in that vikalpa samadhi state. The advanced level is nirvikalpa samadhi, where very few of them could reach, like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa or Swami Vivekananda or Ramana Maharshi or Shirdi Sai Baba, or to name a few of them. This is the state which needs lot of penance. Not everyone can reach to this level. Specifically, when we talk about classical dance has the tenacity and power. The individual who is learning, he or she, has that capacity to reach this nirvikalpa samadhi level. And ultimate goal for the individual who is learning classical dance or classical music is to reach that nirvikalpa samadhi, which is nothing but asamprajnata state. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. This has to be understood in depth. This is for the yoga practitioner as well and meditational practitioners as well. However, I will speak about the types of meditations wherein I will touch upon. But before getting into that, one needs to understand these points as well. These are very important aspects for yoga practitioners and for the individuals who are practicing dance, classical dance, looking at the therapy value, therapeutic value there. Also needs to understand these samadhi types as to why it has to be understood. One needs to get to that supreme state. That is very important. And the prime responsibility and the prime goal of a teacher has to be this. It is not that mere teaching steps or mere learning and mere performance. If you want to give that positive energy, if you want to radiate that energy, that shakti to the audience, to the society, one needs to understand this. Today the apathy is that we are not getting to understand these terminologies as such. One needs to understand this. Today rapes or gang rapes or whatever. When a classical dancer dances, gives a performance, the amount of energy that is radiated is enormous. One needs to understand this. I am telling this because I have experienced this, and that is the reason I am able to tell this. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. It's a very key aspect, prime aspect. And one needs to understand Purusha from a viewpoint of the intelligence and intellect. Purusha here means Shakta, Ishvara Sarupa. As I spoke about it in my previous video, Purusha has the cross reference to these samadhis. Unless and until one knows about the Purusha aspect or the Ishvara Tattva or the 36 Tattvas of the Ishvara, he or she cannot get to the supreme state of the mind, which is nothing but Samprajnata. And this is also called Vikalpa Samadhi state. After that, you reach to the Nirvikalpa Samadhi state, which is nothing but Asamprajnata. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. It's as simple as that. Though it may be sounding very simple, today I see yoga practitioners and teachers coming up and telling that we will teach you the self-realization in half an hour's time, 1 hour's time. But it requires a lot of practice, lot of understanding. One needs to have the clarity of the restlessness and turbulence and powerful and obstinacy attitude and the true definition of it from a viewpoint of philosophy and spirituality. Sad but truth be told, this is not being understood by anyone. Even a dance teacher is not teaching this. Recently, when I went for a show, or when I went to a place, I was being asked by a teacher, how is the dance? How is the lyrics? But nobody was talking about energies. What is the kind of energy that you got out of it? Ladies and gentlemen, this is the sad part of it. One needs to understand this. A classical dance is not about entertainment. Classical dance is all about like generating that positive energy, the highest level of energy. That is the reason why they are considered Sri Vidya Upasakas indirectly. It has to be practiced in that way. Thus, the pointers from this video to the individuals, aspiring dancers, scholars, medical practitioners, and scientists in their respective domains is understanding of samadhi, understanding of purusha aspect, or the human existence aspect, and the nirvikalpa samadhi, vikalpa samadhi, and what is that supreme state meaning? How is it directly related to the four traits, restlessness, turbulence, powerful and obstinacy attitude? Thus, I conclude this video with a positive note. Stay blessed. Have a blissful life. Shri Guru Pyanna. Have a nice day ahead.